The switch capacitance minimization. In previous class, we discussed about one of the technique of minimizing switch capacitance. That was the hardware software core design. And we discussed how by giving proper weight to software in a system design, we can minimize the switching activity and the power dissipation. We discussed about two architectures, superscalar architecture and VLIW architectures. Superscalar architecture utilizes instruction level parallelism, and whereas in VLIW architecture, long instruction words are used to perform multiple tasks at the same time. The VLIW more rely on software, whereas the superscalar relies on hardware for code translation and dispatching, etc. So it was also discussed that for a given task, the VLIW architecture-based transmitter processor performs better in terms of power requirement. So the power dissipation was found to be very, very small in transmitter processor compared to the superscalar counterpart Pentium processors. In today's class, we are going to discuss about two techniques of switch capacitance minimization. We'll be discussing about the bus encoding, and we'll also talk about the clock gating. We'll see how these techniques could be useful for minimizing the switching capacitance, switching capacitances. So here we go to the bus encoding. Bus encoding technique is used to minimize the power dissipation, to minimize the switching activity and power dissipation. The main motivation behind this bus encoding is in a system bus. In any hardware, there are many transmission lines, you can say system buses, that connects the major subsystem of the given system, like CPU, memory, input output units will be interconnected to each other with the system level buses. So a lot of data transmission happens over system level buses. So if these data are uncorrelated, if the data that are being transmitted over the period are not very much correlated, then what will happen? A lot of switching activity will happen on the system buses. And system buses are the capacitance associated with the system buses is much larger than that of the internal capacitance of the transistors or the circuit. If large number of switching activity will happen over the system buses, that will result into a lot of power dissipation. So we will discuss about a possible solution could be before a data is transmitted over a system bus, if it is encoded properly, so that a controlled correlation is introduced in the transmitted data, then the switching activity can be minimized, and therefore the power dissipation because of the signal transitions in the system buses can be minimized. Okay, so the Idea is like this. Let's say that there are three lines here in the system buses, you can say. Let's say there are four lines, and let's say that a data sequence is being transmitted here, which is 1, 0, 0, and 0. So the next data sequence, if it is that is being transmitted, is let's say 0, 1, 1, and 1. So you can see that all I mean this line, which was initially charged to let's say highest potential level VDD, that will be switched to the lower potential level, and this line is now switched from 0. It will be charged from to higher potential VDD. This will be also charged to higher potential VDD. This will also charge to higher potential VDD. Then again, let's say that the next sequence is this. Let's say that the next sequence is again 1, 0, 0, 0. Then again, you can see that frequent switching will happen over the transmission line. And since the transmission lines have larger capacitance, then of course the power requirement will be more. So the bus encoding technique is based upon the control correlation that is introduced in the transmitted data. The data that is to be transmitted over the transmission line are encoded before the transmission, and they are encoded in such a way that the next sequence of data will be quite similar to that of the previous sequence. And if it happens, then you can see that less switching activity will happen. Let's say that after correlation, after the introduced controlled correlation, let's say that the next sequence data is, let's say that the previous data was 1, 0, 0, 0, and the next sequence data is, if it is 1, 0, 0, and 1, then you can see that only one transition happens here, and therefore this line retain the same potential. These two lines retain the same potential. This line will now switch from low potential to higher potential. So in a way, we can say that the switching activity has been reduced significantly, and therefore the power can be minimized. So there are various techniques for bus encoding, and we can classify these techniques in two different categories: the redundant one and the non-redundant category. The redundant bus encoding category and the non-redundant bus encoding category. So in case of you can see non-redundant encoding, so first let us see the arrangement, what is done, what is done for the bus encoding. So you see that there is a sender chip here which is going to send the data, and the receiver chip which is going to receive the data. And in between, these are the system buses. These are the lines over which the data is to be transmitted. So you can see that the sender hardware is not directly sending data to these transmission lines, these system buses, but rather this data is first encoded by this encoder, and then it is transmitted over the transmission line. And then the data is received and decoded by a decoder in it at the receiver chip, and finally that data is the receiver. So you can see that the sender data here, the data that is being, that is to be supplied, is being encoded, and the way this encoding is done, we classify the bus encoding technique as a non-redundant or the redundant technique. In a non-redundant bus encoding technique, you see that n bit data is translated into another m bit code, where m is equal to n, means a 4 bit data will be translated to another 4 bit data. So with a 4 bit data, if there will be 2 to the power 4 sequences, the 2 to the power 4 possible sequences will be mapped to another 2 to the power 4 sequences by this encoder, and then that encoded data will be transmitted over the transmission line. So it's pretty obvious that in redundant coding scheme, no additional transmission lines will be required. If, for example, if you had to, let's say, send a 4-bit data, so I need 4 transmission lines. No additional transmission lines are required. However, in a redundant coding schemes, the n-bit data is translated to m-bit data. N-bit data is mapped to m-bit data, where m is greater than n. So, for example, a 3-bit code will be translated to 4-bit code or 5-bit code. And therefore, if the original data that was to be transmitted was a 3-bit data, and now it is converted to a 4-bit data, then the additional transmission lines would be required in this case. So, in case of redundant coding scheme, basically the additional data lines are required to transmit the redundant bits. And 2 to the power n different data words are mapped to 2 to the power m data words by encoder, as we discussed. The encoder can have a memory, or it can be memoryless, depending upon the nature of the encoding scheme. So the coding schemes, encoding schemes can be classified as a redundant coding and non-redundant coding scheme. So now we'll take some examples of these redundant and non-redundant coding scheme, and we shall discuss how these coding schemes are implemented and how they could be useful for minimizing the switching activity. So first, let us take one redundant scheme, which is gray coding. The gray coding is a redundant coding scheme where a 4-bit binary data can be converted into 4-bit gray code data. So here you can see that the binary and gray code representation of a number, decimal number 0 to 15 is presented. And 000 is binary 000, and 0 is gray code 000, and 5 is, let's say, binary 010, and gray code is 011, 15 is 111, and it is 1000. So if we look at the binary code representation of the decimal data, then you will see that there are many transitions that will happen. For example, if we move from 000 to 001, there is a one transition. When we move from 0001 to 0010, there are two transitions. One, the LSB, the least significant bit, is now become 0, and the next significant bit has now become 1. So two transitions have happened. And then here, one transition has happened. 0 has now become 1, and 1 remains as it is. Now you can see that the three transitions then happened: 120, 120, and 021. So in a binary code representation, the number of transitions will be greater than if we represent the decimal value by the gray code. In gray code, when we move from one sequence to next sequence, there will be only one transition. So whether it is 000 to 001 transition, or it is 1100 to 1101 transition. So in gray code, basically the sequences are more correlated compared to the binary code, because you can see that in binary code more than three transitions are possible, but here when we move from one sequence to next sequence, only one transition is actually is allowed. So for the total representation from 0 to 15 decimal number, there will be 30 transition happen if we go for binary code representation, whereas in gray code there are only 16 representations. So you can say that there is a 50% reduction in the switching activity if we adopt the gray coding before the data transmission, and simultaneously we also consider that the data that is to be transmitted is sequential in nature. If we have to transmit the system data using the gray code, then there is no much benefit of the correlation of the sequences, because two subsequent sequences are correlated in the gray code. So if in a particular application, if sequential data are to be transmitted, then the gray code is a better scheme compared to the binary coding scheme. So here you can notice that gray coding has been applied to the address lines for both instruction and data access. So simulation results show that the technique is more effective for the instruction fetching, as the instructions are fetched from the sequential location. So we have to send the we have to transmit data which are sequential in nature. So if the data are sequential in nature, then the gray code is going to perform better than the binary code, because in that case sequences will be very much correlated, and therefore the less switching activity will happen. So the encoder and decoder for the gray coding scheme is very easy to design. You need some XOR gates. XOR gates, with the help of XOR gate, we can design encoder, and similarly another XOR gates can be used to design the decoder. So here this table shows the performance of the gray code for different benchmark programs. So the binary coding and the gray codings are done for instruction address and for the data address, and these benchmark programs are run, and the performance of the two coding schemes are compared here, and this value are these values are basically the bit transitions per second, bit transitions per second. So for example, 2.46 bit transitions per second. If we look at the instruction address, then you can see that the corresponding number which is written here for the gray code is always smaller than the binary code. So here for the benchmark program FastPins, you can see that the binary code is 2.46, whereas for gray code it is 1.03 only, and for NAND here it is 2.42, it is only 1.57. For CAT it is 2.43, it is only 1.454. So for instruction addresses, the gray code performs better because of the reason that we have discussed earlier, whereas for data address, you can see that the gray code doesn't perform better than the binary code, because this the first benchmark program, the bit transition per second in binary coded scheme is lesser than the gray code scheme. For another one, it is smaller than the gray code. Bit transition rate in gray coding is less than this, but there is no clear advantage. If we compare this column with this column, and you can see that there is no clear advantage if we use a gray code for coding the data before the transmission over the system bus. So this is the gray coding scheme that is used. It's a redundant technique and non-redundant technique, and this is used to minimize switching activity in certain applications. Then we have another coding scheme, which is one hot coding scheme. So this is a non-redundant technique, and in one hot coding scheme, you see that a n-bit data is encoded to 2 to the power n bit data. Okay. For example, if let's say that there are 2-bit data and 2-bit data, and that is with 2-bit binary data, we'll have basically, let's say that the 2-bit 2-bit binary data, that is that can be 00 or could be 01, 10, and 11 here. So this 2-bit binary data will be mapped to 4-bit data. So to represent this, we have four bit data sequence. So that could be let's say 0 0 0 and 0. Okay, let's say it's 0 0 0 and 0. Then let's say that 0 0 0 into 0 0 0 1, and to represent the next sequence, which is 1, it could be 0 0, let's say 1 0. To represent this number 2, it could be 0 1 0 0. To represent this sequence, we have 1 0 and 0. So the different sequences are similarly, if we have, let's say, to represent decimal number 1 2 3 and 4, then to represent 1, we have this sequence 0 0 0 1. To represent 2, we have 0 0 1 0. To represent 3, we have 0 1 0 0, and to represent 4, we have 1 0 0 0. So what is done? Only a single 1 will be there in the data sequence, and the position of that 1 will basically tells us about the weight of that particular sequence. You can see that to map a n bit data, we need 2 to the power n lines. For example, if there is a 3 bit data, then to map that, we have we have a sequence with 8 bits, and each time when a data will appear here at the input of the encoder, output of the encoder will generate a sequence at the output with that sequence will have only 1, depending upon the weight of the okay. So of course, to represent n bit data, we need here 2 to the power n lines. So since the number of lines here are the code that is being transmitted has more number of bits compared to the actual data sequence that is to be transmitted, then we can consider this a redundant technique of encoding. And it's pretty obvious that for each sequence, I mean, when the next sequence is transmitted, then there is a change of 2 bits. 2 transition will happen from one sequence to next sequence. For example, let's say that the first sequence is 000. Then we have to transmit this 1 1, we have to transmit 4. Then we have the next sequence that is to be transmitted is 1 0 0 0. So one has to be one has to become 0, and this 0 is changing to 1. So there will be 2 transition always for the next sequence, and you can see that this is a very, very, I mean, in some cases, it will be a very, very significant reduction in the switching activity, because only 2 transition will happen, but we have to pay the cost. The cost is, you can see that extra hardware is required. You see, the more system bus lines are actually required, and of course, encoder has to be designed in that way, so that it will convert the input sequence to a desired format. So this is one hard coding, and the one hard coding is use to minimize the switching activity over the system buses. Okay, then the next coding scheme is the bus inversion coding. The bus inversion coding is again a redundant coding scheme, and you can see that the number of bits in the encoded data will be more than the number of bit in the actual data that is to be transmitted. The good thing is, unlike the previous case where the 2 to the power n lines were required to transmit the data, here we need only one additional line for data transmission. So the n bit data is translated to n plus 1 bit data. So extra hardware is not required. I mean, especially for this. Transmission lines, we need only additional line to transmit the data from the sender chip to the receiver chip. And the coding scheme is essentially this: if the first the Hamming distance is calculated between si minus 1 to si. The Hamming distance is greater than n by 2, then the complement of si will be sent. If Hamming distance is if d is greater than n by 2, where n is the number of bits in a data sequence, the complement of the number, then rather than transmitting si, the si complement will be transmitted. And if Hamming distance d is less than n by 2, then the data sequence, original data sequence, will be transmitted. For those who don't understand this Hamming distance, here essentially means that the number of transition that is happening. For example, in a gray code, the Hamming distance is 1. Okay, because for the next sequence, there is a change of only 1 bit. Okay, so if there is a, let's say, 4 bit data, and if the current sequence, the current sequence that is to be transmitted is compared with the previously transmitted sequence, then if the let's say that the four out of 4 bits, the 3 bits are now changed, so we'll say that the Hamming distance is 3. Okay, and if the Hamming distance is 3 for 4 bit of data, so the current sequence will not be transmitted as it is. The complement of the current sequence will be transmitted. Okay, for example, if let's say that the current sequence, that is the previous sequence that was transmitted, was 0, 1 and 1. Okay, so the current sequence that is to be transmitted that over the system bus is now, let's say that it is 1 0 0 0. So what you see that there are 4 transitions here. I mean, this is 4. 0 is changing to 1, 1 changing to 0, 1 changing to 0, and this one is also changing to 0. So Hamming distance is 4. So if data sequence, if this data sequence is transmitted over the system bus, then you will see that there is a lot of switching activity over the system bus, and that will require that will cause a lot of power dissipation. So in this case, since Hamming distance is greater than n by 2, n is 4, so 4 by 2, it's greater than 2, because the actual transition is 4. So rather than transmitting this as it is, we'll send the complement of this, and the complement of this is going to be 0, 1, 1. But how the decoder at the receiver end will identify that this is a complement or original sequence? So this is determined by the information will be given on this additional line. You can, as I told earlier, that the n bit code will be transmitted to n plus 1 bit code. So the additional bit which is being used is will carry the information that whether the original sequence is transmitted or the complement of the original sequence is transmitted. So in this scheme, you can see that the 10 to 20% switching activity are reduced in certain applications. Okay, so it's a good technique for reducing the switching activity, considering the fact that there is not the requirement of the transmission line is not as stringent as in the one hot coding scheme. So now we can discuss how the encoder and the decoder of this bus inversion coding scheme will be designed. It's a very, very simple implementation that can be that will be discussed in the previous slide. Okay. So here is the hardware realization for the bus inversion coding scheme. So this is the data, n bit data that is to be transmitted. And this is the previous sequence that was transmitted. BTN minus 1 was the previous sequence that was transmitted before the current data sequence. So the data that is to be transmitted and the previous data sequence that was transmitted, so you see that this is your, our encoder part. Okay? And this is the decoder part. The encoder part, this is the data that is being transmitted over the system bus. With this additional bit, which will tell us whether the original sequence is transmitted or the complement of that is being transmitted. So this is n bit data and this is another 1 bit. So the total data that is transmitted is basically n plus 1 bit data. So now here the previous sequence that was transmitted is being compared with that of the current data sequence, and this hardware will calculate the Hamming distance, and the Hamming distance will be then compared with compared with the n by 2. So if there are, let's say, 4 bit data, then that will be compared with 2. So if Hamming distance is greater than 2, then this hardware will generate output 1 here. Okay. And this output is basically the input of an XOR gate. And you know that the property of an XOR gate. We have a variable x and that is XORed with 1. So what we get? XOR complement. So we'll have x into 0 plus XOR into 0, x y bar plus x bar y. So XOR into 1 is basically XOR. If one of the input of an XOR gate is 1, then the output is going to be the complement of the another input. So if the output here, if the output of this hardware is 1, which is essentially a comparator, which includes a comparator hardware that will calculate first the Hamming distance, and then that will be compared with the threshold, which is n by 2, and then the decision is made. Decision is 1 here, then that is one of the input of this XOR gate. and this exergate will produce now a data complement here. Okay, so the complement of data means S complement will now be transmitted, and along with the S complement, this decision here, which was 1, this is also to be transmitted as a PT minus 1. So if the additional bit that is being transmitted is 1, then the data is in the complement form. And if not, if it is 0 here, if the decision made here is 0, means if the Hamming distance of the current data sequence is less than n by 2, then this hardware will produce 0. And if the one of the input of this XOR gate is 0, then the output will be the original data sequence. So here the data sequence will be data T. So data T will be transmitted with this PT minus 1 to be 0. So if PT minus 1 to be 0, then the receiver will understand that sequence is coming, data sequence, original data sequence is coming. If PT minus 1 is 1, then this receiver will understand that the data sequence is in the complement form. And the decoder design is very simple. You can see that it's only an XOR gate here, and one of the input is XOR gate is the original data, another input is this additional bit. So if this additional bit was 1, then this one is going to complement what is actually coming over here. Here the data complement is coming with 1 PT minus 1 to be 1. So the output here will be the complement of this data, which was actually the complement of the original data. So complement of the complement will get the original data at the output here. Okay, but if the PT minus 1 is 0, means that the original data without any encoding has arrived at the decoder end. And since if you are performing X XOR 0, then basically you will get X. Okay. So no change in the original data, and because the at the output of this XOR gate, original data will appear. The decoder designing is very, very simple. It's simply an XOR gate for the purpose. The encoding will be done properly. Honey, please turn off your mic speaker. Please turn off your headphone. Okay. So this was the bus inversion coding scheme. Now the another coding scheme is the T0 coding scheme. The T0 coding scheme. So this is again a redundant coding scheme, and in this case the data n bit data is converted to n plus 1 bit data. And in this scheme again, one additional bit is transmitted. So the additional bit is about the increment. Okay. So this will carry the information that if there is an increment or there is no increment. So the encoding mechanism of this T0 coding is like this. So BT is the data sequence that is to be transmitted, and along with the transmitted data sequence, we have the increment bit. Okay, so if the increment bit is 1, you can see, then the previous data sequence is transmitted. The previous data sequence is transmitted with the information that there is an increment in that bit information. Then if there is a if the increment is 1, then there is a the data that is sent is the previous bit sequence. And this increment bit 1 will tell the receiver chip or the decoder here that a constant increment has to be made in the data that has been received. Okay, and if the increment here is let's say that 0, then it means that then the receiver decoder will make a decision that the data sequence, the original data sequence, has been arrived. Okay, for example, let's say that if the bit sequence, if the increment bit is let's say 0 and the following bits are 1010, okay, it simply means that that this data is the original data that was to be intended, that was to be sent. Okay, so the decoder will take this as the original data and will send to the receiver. Okay, whereas if the input sequence is if the received sequence at the decoder is 1 1 0 1 0, okay, so in this case since the increment bit is 1, then the 1 0 1 0 is basically was the previous data sequence that was to be transmitted. In this case, the decision will be made that the actual data that was to be transmitted was 1010 plus S, where S is the increment. So the decoder already know about the S. S may be let's say plus 1 or plus it may be 1 or it may be 10 or it may be 11, depending upon the programming. Let's say that S is 001. So the decoder will understand that the actual data that was to be transmitted was 1011. Okay, so the data that was transmitted here with this one is 1010, and this 1010 was basically the previous sequence. So if since it was a previous sequence, there was no change in this sequence. Only the increment bit was in the previous sequence it was 0, now it has become 1, so there is change of one bit only. But the receiver now will automatically receiver itself will add the increment and get back the original data sequence. Since we are considering here the increment to be only 1, then it seems that so even in this case you can see that the transition is of how many bit. The original data that has come was that was to be transmitted was 1011, and the data that was transmitted was 1010. So if you compare this, now 0 has become 1, and 1 has now 1 is 1, and this 0 is 0, 1 is 1. So in this case, it seems that there is a change of only one bit, but in bigger data sequences and with larger increment value. This could be the actual data that was to be transmitted, maybe largely different, maybe significantly different from the original data that was actually that was actually transmitted. So by adopting this T0 coding scheme, lot of switching activity can be minimized, and therefore the power dissipation can also be reduce significantly. Okay, so these are some coding scheme. Okay, so the which also discuss the hardware for this T0 coding scheme. So hardware is pretty simple. You can see that here is BT, the bit sequence that is to be transmitted. This is the current sequence that was to be transmitted, and here is a subtractor. And this BT is going through a D flip flop. So here we get a BT minus 1. Okay, so BT minus 1 is the previous data sequence is subtracted from the current data sequence, and This the difference output the out the difference here the difference of this subtractor is now compared by a comparator, and the another input of the comparator is the increment. Okay, so if this difference is not exactly, if it is exactly equal to this increment, then the comparator output is 1. So the increment bit now becomes 1, and if this is 1, the output of this comparator is 1. So you see that this is also fed to this mux. This is a 2-to-1 mux. So there are two inputs, 0, the two input line 0 and 1. 0 is basically BT, the data sequence that is to be sent at the moment. The another input is the BT minus 1, which was the data sequence that was earlier, just previous to this data sequence. So if the increment is 1 here, so increment 1 will, means this input will be selected, which is BT minus 1. So the BT minus 1 will be transmitted along with the increment 1. So the increment is 1. And then the previous data sequence will be transmitted to over the system bus, and that will be received at the decoder. And the decoder design is also very simple. Decoder can very easily decode that when the decoder decodes that the increment input is 1. So you can see that this is the increment input. So when increment input is 1, then this input line of this mux will be selected, which is equal to this input line of the mux will be selected, which is nothing but the BT minus 1 plus S. So the increment will be added to BT minus 1, and that will be the output. Okay. Whereas if BT is in such a way, if BT is in such a way that this comparator produces 0 here. So this 0 will select this input of the mux, first input of the mux, and which is BT as it is. And this BT will be actually transmitted, the original data sequence will be transmitted with 0 increment bit. And if the increment bit is 0, then you can see that the decoder, at the decoder end, the input line which will be selected is this 0 line, which is the original data sequence BT, and that goes to the output. So you can see that the decoder, which is implemented with the help of one mux and one adder and one D flip flop, is able to decode the encoded data sequence. So the T0 coding scheme is also very useful, especially if in especially when there is a you can see a constant increment in the data sequences. In that case, the switching activity can be minimized significantly if T0 coding scheme is adopted. Okay. So we have discussed about the bus encoding schemes, and you can see that redundant and non-redundant coding schemes are used. They have their own advantages and disadvantages. So depending upon the nature of the data, one or other techniques could be suitable. And these techniques are widely used in processors to minimize the switching activity at the system bus, to reduce the dynamic power dissipation. Okay. The next topic is the clock gating. Although now you have a brief idea about the clock gating, we have discussed this in case of dynamic power dissipation technique. When you're talking about dynamic power dissipation techniques, so here the discussion will be a little bit more extensive on the clock gating. And the clock gating is an important technique to reduce the switching activity, because we discuss that in a given processor at a particular instant of the time, it may happen that lot of hardware remains inactive. They don't participate in electronic activity. In that case, it's better to make those units off to minimize the switching activity. So the clock gating is very, very useful to switch to stop the clock to the units that are not participating in the electronic activity. And the clock gating is very, very important because of also this fact that you can see that the 50% of the dynamic power originates from the clock related circuits. The total contribution of the clock related circuits in the dynamic power, because clock is continuously running and the clock is being transferred to our clock is being conveyed to the different units over the clock has to travel long distance and it will reach to each and every unit of the hardware, and the clock is continuously running, and those hardwares are basically nothing but some parasitic capacitances. So because of the clocks, the total clock contribution in the total dynamic power is around 50%. So if the clock is managed properly and judiciously, then a lot of dynamic power can be reduced, can be minimized. So this picture I have already shown you that if the clock is running, then both dynamic power as well as the leakage power dissipation will be observed, and if the clock is not changing, then only the leakage power will be observed in the hardware. So the clock gating can be implemented in this particular fashion. So we have a clock gating circuit CG, which has one input as an enable input, and then another input is clock. The clock is basically the global clock here that is continuously running with continuously running, and the enable will be decided based on this combinational circuit. So this combinational circuit will be an intelligent circuit, you can say, which will determine when this the functional when the switching activities of this functional unit has to be stopped. So this hardware will find a condition that under these conditions the switching activity of this functional unit has to be stopped, and accordingly this functional unit this will release an input here. So this input of this functional unit will actually will be responsible for here the gated clock. Okay, depending upon this input, the clock will be observed at this point, or clock can be stopped. So the designing of this functional block is also very, very important, because if this functional block is not properly designed, then the performance of the overall system will be badly affected. So the hardware realization of this clock gating unit is very, very simple. You can see that this can be implemented either using an AND gate, or it can be implemented using an OR gate. Okay. So when it is implemented with an AND gate, then the enable is one of the input, clock is the another input, and if enable input is zero, then the clock will be zero here. Clock will not be propagate. Clock will be stopped by this AND gate. But if the enable input is one, then the clock will propagate through this gate, and and the clock can be delivered to to the hardware which is to be driven by this clock. Okay, but the problem, one of the problem that may appear in this kind of clock gated hardware clock gating hardware realization is this. You can see that if there is a switching activity happens at this enable input, because you can see the enable input is the output of this functional unit, and this could be a combinational circuit and multi-stage combinational circuits in fact. So there could be some switching activity happen, there could be some non-uniform propagation delays in this functional unit, and as a result there could be some glitches present here at the output of this functional unit. And if a glitch is present at the this enable input, this glitch can propagate through at the output here. Okay, ideally let's say that the clock was this enable input was expected to be zero. So when enable input was expected to be zero, there was no clock here, clock gated output was zero. But let's say that some glitch appeared because of glitch appeared in the functional unit that is producing the enable input. So because of these two, because of the glitches, you can see the glitch is high level. And if let's say that at that particular time the clock is at the high level, so this glitch will propagate. Okay, and if the glitch propagates here, then it can be treated as a clock, and that clock will actually give rise to the switching activity in the subsequent hardware, and that will result into the power dissipation. So however, if this glitch appears in this half cycle of the clock, second half cycle of the clock, this won't have any impact. This will not be. So this problem can be improved by using a D flip-flop here. The enable input is not directly supplied to this AND gate, but rather the enable input is first given is feed to this D flip-flop, and the D flip-flop output is then given to the this AND gate. So this D flip-flop will introduce some delay, and it will ensure that if there is a glitch appears, that will not reach in this first half of the clock, it will reach in the second half of the clock only. And then this glitch, if it is there here at the enable input, cannot propagate further. So a better clock gating circuit could be this, which will include a D flip-flop along with the AND gate. One of the input is the clock, and another input is the enable input for this clock gating circuit. This is one of the realization which is done with the AND gate. There is another realization which is done with the OR gate here, you can see. So the one of the input is the clock, but the another input is enable, and you can see that the enable input is not given directly, but the complement of this EN is given to this clock getting this clock getting OR gate. Okay, and in this case you can see that if the enable input is 1, if this enable input is 1, so the actual contribution of this is 0 to this OR gate, and in that case the clock, whatever the clock is, that will propagate. But if the enable input is 0 in this case, so the actual contribution of this input is 1 to this OR gate, and in this case there will be 1 plus clock, therefore the output will be 1. So whatever the switching activity happening here at the clock input, that will be actually blocked, and at the output we'll get only a high level state. Okay, so when the output is in the high level state, we will assume that no clock is being propagated, unlike this case, unlike in the previous case. In this case, when the output was 0, no clock was propagating. In the second implementation, when the output is 1, then we'll assume that the no clock is propagating. Okay, and this is relatively better. This implementation is relatively better than the first implementation, because the glitch issue can be naturally neutralized. Because if the glitch appears in this first half of the clock, then the glitch is basically one. And if glitch is one, then its contribution is zero here. So it is zero, but this zero is being added with the high clock. So it's always one. So no transition will happen. Okay. But if this glitch appear in the second half, then there could be a problem, because in that case, the output is now expected to go to the zero, and this will create a problem. But the functional unit that will be designed earlier, designed to produce this enable input, that will be designed in such a way that if a glitch appears, that appears in the first half of this clock only. Okay. So these are basically the design. These are the better clock gating circuits that can be used for the clock gating purpose. In the next class, we'll be talking about the granularity of the clock gating, the different level of the design abstraction where the clock gating is used, and we'll discuss how the implementation of the clock gating is going to improve the performance of in terms of the power dissipation minimization. So let's stop here today. If you have any question, you can discuss, you can ask.
T0 coding, how do we know what should SP?
T0 coding?
How do we know what is S there? Is it predefined?
Yes, will be predefined depending upon the applications. It could be increment of one sequence, it could be increment of two sequence. Depending upon the applications, it will be chosen. Any other question? Okay. We'll stop today. We'll continue this next class after once we finish this discussion, then I will share the PowerPoint. Okay. Thank you very much.